We don't care, and it shows.
You're listening to Outrageous Talk Radio, 100.7 The Buzz.
You're kind of the Cartier of caca, aren't you?
LoveLine is meant for an adult audience. LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised.
Adam Carolla. Dr. Drew.
I'm not modeling anymore for the two of you.
LoveLine.
Yes, and it is LoveLine. I'm Dr. Drew. Adam is away. He's a genius, you know. He's at the Aspen Comedy Festival. And graciously, he's allowed me to sit here by myself and entertain you guys tonight. So I always love this. And tonight, I'm really delighted to introduce Ron Lester, who plays Sugar Daddy on Popular Thursday nights, 8 p.m. WB. Ron,
what's up?
Ron's been here before. Ron likes this show. And Ron, you were last year when you guys were promoting Varsity Blues, right?
Yeah, me and Eli Swinton.
And you were kind of telling me about that experience. It was all right, wasn't it?
Loved it.
Yeah.
Every time somebody called in, they was like, you know, I got warts on my testicles. It was so hard not to laugh, and it was like I started laughing. And you give me that look, like, okay, be serious. You know.
I'm fine. I remember the night. I remember you guys. You guys were great. And now you also play a role on Freaks and Geeks.
Yeah, I play.
These are two very popular shows, by the way.
Yeah, you know.
It's cool. And I just had Busy Phillips. I just left her about an hour ago. She
did my
webcast at drdrew.com, and I spent a half hour with her, and she really opened up about a lot of stuff.
She's awesome.
She's got multiple layers to her, and she actually flipped something out of her nose. She didn't tell us anything about that last night. She's got a big horseshoe hanging from her septum. You aware of that?
No.
And she flips it up inside.
The earring thing, the nose ring.
But it's up out of her septum, and it's like a horseshoe.
No.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, and it goes halfway to her brain when she flips it up inside. No, you asked me you to show you that. I'm telling you. Oh, yes.
Busy's beehive.
So it's a recurring guest role. Bully. You play a bully. Seidelman. Okay. And then, let's see, you were last year in January, and you had to cancel your run with, you were scheduled to come up here in December, and what happened?
Man, it was just the schedule for their show for Popular. It was just crazy.
So it was just too much.
It was.
We understand. Hey, we do stuff.
No, I know. But I mean, like, sometimes we go from 8 o'clock in the morning to 1 o'clock in the morning. And it's like I was so trying to bust get out of there. And
look, we understand this show is in the middle of the night, and listen, it screws with my day every day. So please,
I was hurt. I was hurt though. I wanted to be here. I was like,
all right, well, now you're here. That's
I'm
all
here.
You're here. And we were talking off the air. You were from Kennesaw, Georgia.
Which
I just was visiting about 2 weeks ago. I was looking for I was in Atlanta for like 6 hours. Which is sort of how I travel. I end up just lighting places for a few hours.
Right.
And I swear to God, I wanted to just sort of taste some of the history. And I was having a guy find me a Civil War museum, and I guess there's one in Kennesaw. We couldn't find it.
Right. It's the General Museum.
Yeah.
When they had the locomotive chase of the Civil War. The General's the only train left.
No, wait a minute. I was in that museum. That's with the big cyclorama.
No.
There's an indoor train in this museum.
That's the Texas.
Oh, okay. All right.
That's the crappy train.
I'm sorry.
The general.
Museum was great. How about the cyclorama?
The cyclorama's great. Anybody who's in Atlanta has to go see the cyclorama.
And I sat in there with two other people. I think the seat's like 4,000.
Yeah.
It's nuts. And people don't know that in the 19th century, a big deal, things that was done a lot, was people would make these big circular, what would you call them, landscapes or sort of recreations of important historical events or even
visual art.
But panoramas, yeah. Big, and this thing moves around you as you sit in this theater, and it's a rendition of the Battle of Atlanta.
Exactly.
Oh, come on. All right, we got to get the calls. That's my cue. All right, I'm Dr. Drew. Adam is away at the Aspen Film Festival. Ron Lester is my guest, and we're going to call. This is Victor, who is 14. Victor?
Yeah.
Hey, what's going on?
Not much. I've been having a problem, since a few years ago. Something happened. I had an erection, and I rolled over in bed, and I heard a loud pop in my penis.
Yeah.
And ever since then, it's starting to curve to the left.
Okay, ow.
Huh?
Well, you broke it. No, seriously.
Did he really?
No. Well, I don't know if that curve to the left was going to happen anyway.
Oh, okay.
Which is a possibility. And usually, did it hurt a lot?
Huh? No, not really.
No, usually the pop is, there's a ligament that I'm using. Actually, I get my diagrams here. Hold on a second.
Are you sure it was a spring in the bed?
No. Look, I'm going to get you the diagram. Yeah. Only Ron's going to be able to enjoy this because I've got diagrams. I've got actually anatomic pictures here.
Do I want to see this?
Yeah, I'm going to show you. Just going to help me describe this. There's actually a ligament. A ligament that holds this, what keeps the penis from falling down when it's erect. Okay.
Oh.
It's like, right?
That could have been it.
Oh, right, dude.
There, ligament of the penis.
I tell you what, did you see...
Suspensory ligament of the penis.
Let me tell you exactly what we're looking at. Did you see Varsity Blues?
Yeah.
Okay, remember the teacher? She was pointing at the penis thing?
Yeah.
That's what I'm looking at right now.
All right, there you go.
Thank you, Dr. Drew.
Suspensory ligament of the penis. And that, like any other ligament, can crack like a knuckle.
Really?
Yeah, and it only happens when the penis is erect, and it cracked, and that's that. Now, you can actually fracture the internal cavernous bodies that keep the penis erect, and they can that really hurts, and there's bleeding and deformity immediately, and that will cause scarring and curvature and whatnot. But I suspect the curvature was just something that was going to happen anyway.
Wow.
There you go. See, Ron, are you learning?
Maybe I should pop mine.
You want to take some notes? David, 16. David?
Hello?
Hi, what's up?
Hey, how are we going?
We're good.
Hey, I'd like to say that I really love your show.
Well, thanks. Which one? Ron's or mine?
Well, yours.
Okay.
And I guess yours is cool, too. But
Ron's on two shows. He's on Popular, which airs Thursday, 8 p.m. on WB.
And Freaks and Geeks.
I don't have promotional bone in my body.
Wasn't that on tonight at 9?
No, that's... that was Felicity, right? No.
I don't know.
Something comes on after Dawson's.
Freaks and Geeks. When does that air?
Monday nights.
Monday, also at 8 or 8:30?
Monday's at 8 o'clock, and then Popular's Thursday nights at 8.
All right, now we're done with that. David, what's going on?
And I like your website, too. It's pretty
thanks.
Cool.
We are starting to actually a promotion today. We're giving away free condoms.
Cool.
If you are over 16 and you just click on the condom that moves across the screen, that you get free condom, they will deliver to your house.
Which brand?
Our own brand.
You have your own brand?
Yep, we do now.
No way.
Yeah, I'm a little mixed about this. Consider it Drew.com's brand, not so much me, but it's a very interesting experience. We're trying to help access for young people who need these things.
You know what? I'd buy it.
It's free. It's free. You just click on it, you'll give off three condoms in your house.
But it's DrDrew.com.
Oh, okay. All right, thanks.
That's cool of you guys.
Well, we're trying. We are really trying to. And tonight, just on the webcast, which nobody watches these webcasts, at least... People don't log on to them the way I think they should. We do these great talk shows every Monday and Wednesday at 7:30 Pacific time. And we had Busy Phillips on tonight, and she was fantastic. She showed me her horseshoe. You can all see her horseshoe that hangs from her nose. She pulled it out.
Ow!
All right, Dave, what's going on?
Whenever my girlfriend and I have sex, I can never get her to orgasm. I mean, I'll orgasm like 3 times before she even gets close to orgasm.
How old is she?
She's 17.
Yeah, but David, the 16, 17-year-old women, most women never, or many women never orgasm during intercourse anyway, or at least not regularly.
They don't?
No. Women actually need other sorts of stimulation. Typically, oral sex does the job. And also, it's important that she sort of know how her own body works. And one of the things women need, I was giving a lecture, interestingly, at Northwestern this week. And this is interesting, Ron. Listen to this. This woman gets up and she goes, how come women don't get to talk about masturbation and aren't taught about masturbation? I thought, wait a minute, what do you mean they can't talk about masturbation? You were standing up in front of 1,200 people and talking about masturbation. She goes, oh, well, okay, well, we talk about it. But ultimately, what I really was able to sort of nail down with her is that there's not a language that makes sense to women or that helps women understand masturbation. It's the language we use about masturbation is a very mechanical, sort of male idea of what masturbation is. We don't tell women about how to sort of find that place, which is an emotional place for them, to let their physiology work. Ron's just shaking his head. That works on radio,
I mean,
by the way.
I agree, but I was going to tell you, my thing is I still think that a lot of people think that the first time you have sex, it's supposed to be a certain way.
Simultaneous orgasm.
It's like people still have to learn what their bodies are. You know, you're not gonna orgasm at the same time. She may not orgasm like right until
at all. Many women don't figure that out until well into their 20s, and certainly not with intercourse. So, David, you got to talk to her. You got to see if she can do it by herself. You got to advise her to help you help her. And women are also ashamed to do that. They believe that if they tell a guy what to do, it's somehow going to hurt his feelings. Correct me if I'm wrong. Guys want to know the right things to do.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. In fact,
I tell you another thing. It's going to sound crazy, but I don't know what your relationship with your dad is. If you're cool with your dad and he knows what you're doing, talk to your dad because he'll know.
That's interesting.
Or your uncle, you know, whatever.
Some other male that has some experience.
Exactly.
Yeah. Noelle, 21.
Yes.
Yep.
I found a lump recently in my breast, and it's about the size of half a golf ball.
Yeah.
And it doesn't hurt. But I don't know how to tell if it's a problem or not.
Well, it's... Where is it?
It's on the upper...
Upper outer?
No, upper middle.
Upper middle. It is difficult for a layperson to know the difference. Are there more than one lump?
I do have fibrous breasts.
Okay,
from my family.
So it's probably just a cyst, right?
Uh-huh.
Here's what I typically tell my patients is, if you feel something different, come back, let me check it out. And that's really the purpose of the self-screening, is to bring you back to the medical system to be sure you're on top of anything that should come up, okay?
Okay.
Do you drink a lot of caffeine or eat chocolate, that sort of thing?
Yes, caffeine.
Cut that back. That may be where this is the stimulation of this is coming from, the recurrence.
Now, is that a typical thing?
Oh, polycystic breast or multicystic or fibrocystic, very, very common, and caffeine makes it worse.
Wow.
Yeah, it can make it worse. Let's see. This is Ted, 27. Ted?
Yes.
What's up?
Well, I think I suffer from what you might call nice guy syndrome.
Right.
I want to know why women seem to be looking for basically a-holes the way they get treated.
Ron?
Yeah.
I got your answer right here.
Ron's a big a-hole. See, he's going to tell you how to do it.
I got your answer right here, man.
Asshole.
You know what it is? It's assholes. You know what I'm saying? What it is girls go for the guys that they think they can change.
Uh-huh.
You know what I'm saying? Because they want to change that guy. You know, and then what happens is when they fix him...
They don't want him anymore.
They don't want him anymore.
They don't want him.
Okay? And then they get their feelings hurt, and then they go back to the nice guy. You see what I'm saying? And they lovey-dove, and they group up with the nice guy, and the next thing you know, they find another bad guy. And so then they leave the nice guy alone because he knows he's going to be there if they get hurt again. Does that make sense?
My question is, should I be the one that ends up changing?
Why would you want to change yourself for somebody else, dude? Isn't your life?
Yeah, Ted, it's a pretty complicated issue, and the important thing is for you not to need to be with another person. Mm-hmm. In other words, in order to be whole, if you are sort of clingy or needy, women really don't like that. It's a little uncomfortable for them, for the most part, except alcoholics. People that they can use that codependency as a way of sustaining their disease will like that rather nicely. Have you ever been involved with somebody like that? Addicts?
No.
Just be careful, because this is really basically, fundamentally, something you could throw under the umbrella of codependency.
Mm-hmm.
And there's some sort of aspect of self that's sort of walled off, and you don't gain access to, typically, unless you're sort of involved with somebody in a certain way. And
okay.
You need to take care of yourself and really work on your own stuff in life, and you'll automatically begin attracting people if you're sort of satisfied with yourself and your work.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
What kind of women do you go for? I mean, you said you're a surfer.
No, actually, I'm in the Navy.
Oh, you're in the Navy?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought they said you were a surfer.
No,
he suffers from
it. Oh, suffers.
Yeah, I suffer.
Hi, dyslexic, can't read.
I'm used to that around here.
No, it's...
Take up surfing, dude. There you go. There's your answer.
It's not one type that I've gone out with. You know, I've gone out with a couple, you know, a lot of different types, and it's not like one type that I'm attracted to.
Yeah, but what, they always sort of work you a little bit?
Yeah.
You know, I wish I could think of some nice pat answer for this. It's a pretty complicated thing when you really dissect it. And I the simplest thing I can tell you to do is to... just do things that make you feel whole and better about yourself, and you will attract better people that really are looking for a relationship and not trying to fix some remote business of the past. Because that's what women do. That's why they do it in adolescence, too. Women are naturally attracted to sort of an alpha male type, but their concept is they really don't want that alpha male because he's not available enough in the way they need him.
Mm-hmm.
So they're gonna sort of rein in that alpha male and convert him into somebody that is more of a... somebody's kind of stay around the nest a little bit. But once they do that, then it's a different guy, and then they're not really that happy with that. And that's the story that Ron was telling you.
Yeah.
But of course, the reality is those guys never change. And,
exactly.
And usually these are workings out of abandonments from the past. And of course, you choose abandoning people, and they abandon. That's it. Trisha, 18.
I was wondering, is alcoholism hereditary?
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's about 50%, whether one or both parents are alcoholics, that you will inherit that gene.
Yeah. Okay.
Why, what's up?
Oh, no, my dad is an alcoholic.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, lately I've just been, like, I party a lot, but, like, lately, like, last month or so, I've just, like, really, I haven't been just drinking just to have fun. I've been, like, drinking to just really get drunk.
Okay, so you got it.
And
do you black out, too?
No, I don't, but, I mean, I drink a lot, like more. I know when I should stop.
The what I sort of tell people your age is, in terms of assessing whether or not they've got the gene, is whether or not you have momentum with substances, whether it seems to be something that's sort of self-perpetuating, independent of what it does for you. In other words, you begin that relationship with a substance to sort of regulate your feelings, right?
Yeah.
You use them because they make you feel better. It's called regulating your affect. If you don't have the internal resources to regulate, you have a brain that's set up in such a way that things like alcohol make you feel a lot better.
Yeah.
And so, we can't dissuade you from that. That works. But once that, sort of, you get over that, then this thing starts having its own momentum, and that's the disease, when it's self-perpetuating and you can't stop even though it doesn't work anymore.
Okay.
And that's what you're heading into, Trisha. You really ought to look at this.
And I'm really trying not to, but it is hard.
Well, Trisha, you got to get help with this.
Yeah.
Again, once the biology starts operating, it's not something that you have willful control over. And it will get more and more intense as time goes along. It's a progressive disease, okay?
Okay.
All right. Take care, will you?
Yeah.
All right. Ron passed me a note saying he really does want to help people. You are helping. You are helping. Believe me, you are. Jay, 21.
Hi.
Hi.
Okay. My mom, just found out last week, or maybe it's about 2 weeks ago, that as a child I was molested. And they didn't live with me at the time. I mean, well, technically, officially, they did, but they both traveled with their jobs. And, well, I moved out pretty young, and I've been on my own ever since. My little brother came with me not too long afterwards.
How old were you?
I'm 21.
How old were you when you moved out?
I'm 16.
All right.
Yeah. And now my dad, well, now that he's discovered this, he wants my little brother to come back home because he's afraid I'm gay. He's afraid I'm going to make my little brother gay. He won't talk to me. My mom will talk to me. And she's saying that my father's hurt.
Wow,
and that
awful situation.
There's really nothing.
What the hell does your sexual orientation have to do with any of this?
Hello?
What does your sexual orientation have to do with any of this?
Well,
nothing.
You don't. Well,
it has nothing to do with nothing here.
Where's your dad live?
He lives in Chicago.
In Chicago?
Yes.
Pretty hardcore people, dude. Are you from Chicago?
Yes.
And you live here now?
No, I live in D.C.
Oh, you live in D.C.?
Yes.
You know, my dad, on certain issues, my dad was the kind of guy where he was very strict on certain things. A lot of stuff was because he didn't understand it.
Can't give an example.
Okay, like with my friends or something like that. I had a friend who was gay.
Huh.
Now, I'm completely straight, and I'm secure with that.
Yeah.
You know? But I was also secure with my friend being gay. I felt no threat from it at all.
Yeah.
But my dad, on the other hand, was very, is new to him. You know, and, being from old school, it was like, if you can't understand it, you kill it.
Wow.
You know, that kind of thing.
It's the Georgian way.
Yeah, it's the Georgia way. It's back mountains kind of thing, you know. It doesn't exist. You know, we didn't see it. It doesn't exist.
Oh.
That's my dad.
You see what I'm saying? So it's, you have to it's hard to sit down, but it's like one of those conversations where you need to sit with your dad and say, listen, let's be rational about this thing and realize.
There's a little more, though.
Oh.
I have had some experiences.
Okay. Yeah, but the point is this has nothing to do with you being gay or not. I'm not surprised you're gay, having been molested by a male, right, when you were a kid?
Right.
And that does tend to change people's orientation sometimes. And that's fine. That's now hardwired into you, and that's you. But what the hell difference does that make in terms of living with your brother or not?
I don't trust my parents' ability to raise him.
All the more reason that you should be keeping your brother. Listen, your sexual orientation has nothing to do with this circumstance. I can understand him being frightened by you having had been sexually abused.
He thinks, and I'm going to abuse my brother now.
That's I understand that. And you have to go back and reassure him that that certainly isn't the case, and that has not been the case, and maybe get your brother to even in with you. How old's your brother?
He's 13.
You don't really want him on at that age in this conversation yet, but you don't want to freak him out at 13. It can be a little overwhelming to him. But the point is, you don't have a history of chaos. You don't have a history of acting out this way on kids. You were abused. Have you been treated for that?
No, actually, no one knew until last week.
Okay.
It was a pretty good secret I kept. I mean,
all right. But again, it has nothing to do with your sexual orientation. You've got to go back and reassure him that you have, because of that event, has not made you sort of deviant in terms of acting out on children. or certainly not on family members. That has nothing to do with it.
And this kind of ruins my chance of ever coming out to my family, you think?
Well, they sound unreasonable. I really am of the opinion.
Wait a minute. Are you saying they don't know that you're gay?
They just know that he was sexually abused. That's what's freaking them out.
That's what they know. Well,
and then they're saying, well, he must be gay then, and that even freaks them more out.
I'm not 100% sure myself. I did some stripping to survive a couple of years ago.
I've had friends who were...
Well, I was a stripper, too.
Only in a movie. No, but they... I have friends of mine who are completely straight who danced in gay bars.
Yeah, that's what I did. They seem to, like, well, never mind.
No, I know what you're saying, dude. I'm just saying, it's
All we're saying is you got to sit down with Dad and reestablish a relationship and be very open and honest with him, and don't get into issues about sexual orientation. If they are unreasonable people as it pertains to that.
But
you got to treat them as unreasonable people.
I'm curious, though. He said it affects now even more his chances of coming out. So what you're saying is your parents don't know that you're gay.
They don't know. They just know that he was sexually abused. And that raised their suspicion that he
right.
could be gay. And that's why they're really after him.
Yeah, so. You know what? How is your relationship with your mom?
My mom, she kind of trusts me, but she never go against my father. He rules that house.
See, that's that strong, hardcore dude. Listen, let me tell you something. In my growing up, I'm tight with my mom. I still am. She's like my best friend. But my thing is, I would hop in there, open up to your mom first. If you're really that tight with her, and you know you have that good relationship, open up with her, because she may be able to guide you into
a softer landing with Dad.
Yeah, exactly.
You guys, we got to go to break. Ron Lester's here, plays Sugar Daddy on the popular show Popular.
That's me.
It airs Thursdays, 8 p.m. on the WB. We'll be right back.
Loveline. Loveline.
Back to Loveline. I'm Dr. Drew. The phone number, 1-800-LOVE-191. If you want the facts, I'll read faxes, 310-854-4455. You know, I had to hook my computer up and get, like, in a chat room, because I was doing that the other... Yeah, I'm going to do that.
Let's do it.
No, I'm gonna do that during the next break. And Adam gets all... Adam, the problem with Adam is he has such bad ADD that you can't... I mean, the second hand going around that clock bothers him. So if I come in here and I do this...
Yeah.
...twice... The whole night's over. It's like it throws him. He can't stand it.
Unacceptable.
And so for me to open up a laptop and to be chatting and working along here
right.
and multitasking, which is something I love doing, no way. No way, Jose.
Dude, so, bring it on.
All right, I'm going to do it.
I'm with you.
All right. So let's see here. This is Diana, who's 18. And again, Ron Lester's the guest. He is from Popular. He plays Sugar Daddy. He's also from Freaks and Geeks. He's a recurring guest.
I remember
plays
him.
Seidelman.
Hey, Diane.
Hi.
How are you?
Great. How are you?
Not bad.
Okay. I remember you from Varsity Blues.
Nice.
And he was in Varsity Blues. That's
yeah.
right.
Thank you.
Great film.
That's where we remember him from. That's where we last saw him.
Yeah. Okay. You want me to ask my question?
Yes, please.
Okay. I'm on Tri-Levelin, which is a form of the birth control pill. And I was informed that if I... I'm at the end of my pack right now. I'm starting my green pills.
You have a 28-day pack.
Yeah. And I'm starting my green pills, and I don't want to get my period this weekend.
Yeah.
So if I just skip to the next pack to start taking the brown pills again, is that bad? Or will it really mess up my cycle?
Why do you want to do this?
Just because I don't want to get my period this weekend.
Why? You getting married or something?
I'm sorry?
Are you getting married or something?
No. No. I have a date. Basically.
Is that date, you expect that date to consummate?
Possibly.
Oh, my goodness. First date? Is it first date with this guy?
I've known him for a really, really long time. It's more of like, okay, well, I mean, it's just, that's not really the point.
Well, that's what we're interested in, then, Anne.
Have you ever had sex with him before?
Have I, with this particular person?
Yes.
No.
What? Hey, by the way, that's fine.
Oh, yeah.
She's known the guy, and she's into him and wants to go on with him. And
yeah. Especially if you know him, like, several years. I mean, that's definitely a friendship.
Don't think of it in terms of this being something that keeps him, though. Some guys, that's it.
Oh, no. It's not about that.
All right. Good for you. Well, you know that you can do this, right?
Yeah. I just want to make sure that it's safe.
It's safe. The triphasic pills, it can get kind of weird. It can really destabilize your endometrium, and you can bleed the rest of the month, and it can be kind of a mess. Monophasic pills, what I usually have people do is skip that week that you wouldn't take it,
uh-huh.
Go ahead and restart, and then once you've been through your honeymoon or your date or whatever it is, then take the week break. You see what I'm saying?
What am I on?
You're on a triphasic pill, so it doesn't. It's not as really clean. You can't really do it that way. It really cause a lot of bleeding or miss your. I can't say do it or not do it. It's not a great thing for you to do.
Okay, so it's
not a big deal.
Yeah, but it does have repercussions.
And it's going to change your period. It could change your period for a while. It's not a big deal, but okay. it will have an effect.
Hey, Diane, make you feel better. I just got off a pill called the Exnol.
Exnol?
It's Exnol. It's like a fat blocker.
Xenical.
Xenical, yeah, thank you.
Yeah, Exnol.
And, that creates oily discharge, so...
Yes, it does. They stated it on national television nightly.
Dude, it's... God. The side effects are longer than an AM radio commercial.
You know? I was like, that's pretty bold, I thought.
But
oh
I took
that's
that.
That's kind of scary.
Dude, you know what? Bleed, sister, because it's a lot better than oily discharge.
So all it's going to do if I do skip the greens and just go straight for my next pack is just going to make me bleed a lot.
Well... You can get cramps. You can get. I mean, there are other side effects you can get into. I mean, look at that list of side effects in your birth control packet. That,
right.
That you're increasing the risk of that kind of thing when you mess around with how the pill's taken. And boy, and the question is, whether it will affect the effectiveness of the pill too. I don't know. I don't know offhand if it would. I suspect it might. Particularly these mini dose pills, they have to be taken at exactly the same time every day, exactly the way they're supposed to be taken. Boy, that's an interesting question. This is Sean of 17. Sean?
Hey.
Hey.
What's up?
How much? We're talking to you. What's going on? I'm here with Ron Lester from Popular.
Hey, I'm glad Adam's gone.
Hey, me too.
He sucks.
He doesn't suck, but...
Drew's better.
Nice to have a break, dude.
Unacceptable.
I kind of... Yeah, I get chills. Go ahead, Sean. What's going on?
I cannot have an orgasm during oral sex.
Okay, there is that group. There's a bunch of guys that fall into that category.
Is there any reason in particular?
I just think it's, I don't know. I suspect it's the quality of stimulation and just the sort of nature of the experience. It's just not something you're into. Oh, Ron's not into it.
No. I'm into it.
Oh, you're not.
I'm into it.
Count you in for it.
Yeah, you know, I like it a lot.
Yeah.
I'm just saying... like the first time I did it, dude, I couldn't come either because of the fact that it was like, dude, she was looking at me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Is this a recurrent theme for you, Sean, or is this just one time?
Well, no, this is, it's recurring, yeah. It seems like. I mean, I've had it a few times and I've only been able to orgasm once.
I just think it's your personal preference.
Stick with the one you know.
Yeah, don't worry about it. Charlie, 16. Oh, there's some data that came out recently, by the way, on oral sex and HIV. That there was something like 108 cases, 708 cases, the only risk for HIV was oral sex.
Really?
So they're finally documenting the sort of transmission rate for this. Charlie.
Yeah.
What's up?
I get obsessive about girls and stuff. And
I can hear it in your voice.
Huh?
I can hear it in your voice. What's going on?
Anyway, I get obsessed about all of my friends that are female and stuff, even when I have girlfriends.
You're 16, you're male. What else is new?
Hmm?
Go ahead.
Anyway, yeah, I get obsessed about them, and even when I have girlfriends, and I just got a new girlfriend, and I was wondering if there's anything I can do to stop doing that kind of stuff.
You said in spite of having a new girlfriend?
What was that?
In spite of having a new girlfriend, you obsess?
Yeah, I just got a new one, and I wanted to be able to stop doing this.
Are you obsessive in any other way? Do you wash your hands excessively? Do you have obsessive thoughts that are intrusive and troubling to you?
Not really. Just mostly with girls and stuff.
And when you obsess, what do you mean you obsess? What do you think about doing?
I can't stop thinking about them, and I get jealous about everything.
This is in spite of having... This is not focused at your girlfriend. This is other women.
Yeah, exactly.
But you still get jealous of your own girl.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, Charlie. You know, how do you, yeah, actually, that crossed my mind. I don't know how you reassure somebody that this person is not going to leave you when they tell you they're not going to leave you, but you need, somehow you need to be more involved with this relationship and more available and more trusting that she's going to stay around and less wrapped up in how convinced you are she's going to leave. It says something about how you feel about yourself.
How many times has this happened to you? I mean, like, how many girls have you been obsessed about?
Probably since I was in, like, seventh grade.
So
like,
yeah, but obsessive, you know, guys obsessing about girls is just such a common thing.
Yeah, I mean,
it's a common thing. I just, what's peculiar, though, is usually a girlfriend sort of takes care of that.
Yeah, that's the problem, that it doesn't for me.
He's a womanizer.
That's actually, some people call me that at school.
Well, do you actually go after these other women?
Not, like, creepy go after them, but, like, you know, talk to them.
But you're not, like, stalking him.
No, nothing like that. Not that creepy.
You just like to talk to him. He's a Mac Daddy, dude. That's all he is.
Charlie, what do you want from us?
I just want to know how to stop doing this. Well, why I do it. You know?
Okay. A, be more involved with the person you're in. Commit yourself to that. B,
absolutely.
Work on things that make you feel better about yourself. Okay? One of the things you may be doing is focusing on other women as a way of staying off the one you're actually involved with. God forbid that she should leave. So you keep going out here, all these other things, you're not really available for this relationship. And the reason you're so convinced that people are going to leave you is you probably have been abandoned in the past, and also suggests you don't feel that good about yourself. Seth, 16.
Yeah.
Hey.
Every time I try to put on a condom or I think about putting on a condom, I just go limp.
Which is why Adam and I have recommended drilling, that you regularly practice putting on a condom.
Really?
And I think that was a great... It was actually Adam's idea. That was a great idea. That ultimately, we got to figure out a condom loader. It's just thing to... And just puts it on.
I thought that's what she was for.
No. Well, they can do that. And some guys... But some guys really just... You know, this breaking the rhythm and doing this thing really, really is troubling to them. But really, what you ought to... I think what you ought to do is, when you're masturbating, practice putting on condoms without losing the erection. I really do want it.
All right.
I think that's what you ought to do. And... God forbid you let this be the reason you don't use a condom. That is not an adequate excuse for not using one.
Absolutely.
Yeah, this is Josh, 18.
Hey, man, how's it going?
Good.
I just need a little advice, man.
Yeah.
Me and my girlfriend, we've been together for about 10 months, right?
Yeah.
Well, when we first started going out, her parents found a letter from one of her friends saying that they, you know, she smoked with me, you know, bud. Mm. Weed. And
how did that letter go, by the way?
Well,
Dear Julie,
we got high.
Well, remember the night you and Josh and I were smoking out big time?
We were blazing the other night, and I thought of you.
No, she just told her, you know, what she did that weekend. And her parents found that, and then in the letter, you know, she had told my girlfriend that, you know, that I was talking to her about, you know, wanting to have sex with her or whatever. And, you know, her parents saw that, too. And, you know, ever since they found that letter, they have not liked me, you know.
How old is she? How old is your girlfriend?
16.
That's why they don't like you.
I just turned 18, but, like, I don't know.
Josh, let me be honest. If I found this letter and my daughter was 16, I'd not be happy.
Dude, I would beat you.
I would not be happy. So what can we do to help?
Well,
if I was her dad, I'd hunt you down.
I've straightened up a lot ever since, you know, that incident, you know. And, I mean, because I dropped out of school last year.
Oh, boy.
And, you know, and then, like, I realized, you know, that wasn't too smart. So I just recently went back to school, you know.
There you go. As long as you got back in there.
Do what?
As long as you got back in school, dudes. Always stay there.
Yeah, and, you know, I mean, I did it for me, but I also did it for her, you know. I mean, because her parents have done everything they can to try to keep us apart. They've, like, told her, you know, they threatened to send her to boarding schools.
All right, but what do you want from us?
I just need some advice, you know. What can I do, you know, to help, you know, maybe get her parents, you know, maybe... You know, let her see that,
okay.
You know, I'm
right.
Not such a bad guy. Because, I mean, I don't do drugs anymore, really.
What drug were you doing primarily?
Well, I mean, the only thing they know about is marijuana.
What was your primary? I don't care what they know about. What was your primary drug?
LSD.
Oh, boy.
Wow. Yeah.
But, I mean, I haven't done that in a while because I had a bad experience, you know.
You know what's really bad about LSD, dude?
I know you
take,
about it.
You take it now, 10 years from now, you can have a major trip.
What you is get major depressions and just anxiety attacks and things.
I mean, I could still look at things for a little bit and it'll start moving around. And
I know, but that's just the visual side effect. It will change it'll change lots of aspects of your brain function permanently. It's a real mess. And you were not a daily pot smoker.
No, not anymore. I used to be.
All right. Here's what I would require of you. Here's what I would need to see. I'd need to see you involved in a 12-step program with a sponsor and going every day. And I'd see you really diligently doing 12-step. I'd have to see you in school. And then I'd have to get to know you as a person. And that would take some doing.
Yeah.
You'd have to hang out there and not date my daughter, but let me get to know you a little bit on a regular basis without you pushing on the daughter thing.
You know what you need to do? You need to do it for yourself, not for her.
What do you mean?
He needs to do it for himself, not for her.
The recovery.
You know what I'm saying?
I figure he's not going to do it for himself, so I'm looking for a way to leverage him into it.
Oh, I hear you. Dude.
Check out MA. NA or MA, Marijuana Anonymous. You'll talk to a lot of people who have been through experiences similar to yourself, and I think you relate rather strongly to that. The guest tonight is Ron Lester. He's from the show Popular.
That's me.
That's you. And you've also on Freaks and Geeks, and the Freaks and Geeks here will be back after this.
Right back with more.
This is Loveline on Outrageous Talk Radio 100.7 The Buzz.
What it is, Third Eye Blind. Welcome back to Loveline, the number 1-800-LOVE-191. I don't know if I gave out the fax number. It's 310-854-4455. Got a fax from a young gentleman on the East Coast asking us to open lines more to the East Coast, which we do. I mean, everybody has equal chance of getting through here. And he's talking about the fact that we should be more open in our discussion about masturbation because people feel too guilty about that in the Jewish community particularly. So,
yeah, I've heard that.
Really? It's interesting. Wow. It's almost surreal. His name is Mort, which is my dad's name. It's like, ooh. Interesting. The guest, it is Ron Lester, Sugar Daddy from Sugar Daddy Unpopular, and also Seidelman. Did I get that right? Seidelman on Freaks and Geeks. And again, I had the pleasure of interviewing Busy Phillips tonight, who was on this show on January 31st, and she did my webcast tonight at Dr.
She's also on Freaks and Geeks.
She's the Kim. She plays the sort of. She said she's the only one that's allowed to have sex on that show. She and her boyfriend.
Yeah.
That the standards of practices are such that in a teenage show, one couple's allowed to have sex.
Yeah, it's like kissing.
It's like Lucy and Ricky days when they have to be on separate beds and one foot has to be on the ground. It's a similar. It's the same idea.
He has to be under these covers.
Now I understand why the producers and directors and writers get kind of pissed off with this stuff because it really doesn't allow them to portray reality.
Yeah.
Really, I mean, it's one thing if people are going over the top. But let's let reality be reflected in art.
It's hard because it's like you do have younger audiences watching these shows, so it's like the networks feel like they have to be very careful when they don't realize the kids that are watching the shows already know about this stuff.
That and really, I believe in I don't know. So first of all, goddamn DirecTV and all these things. There's so much stuff on there already,
yeah.
And I have to police my television like it's some sort of a ticking bomb all the time in our house. I really, really worry about that thing sitting there. And what they show on the networks is not going to change that.
If you're worried about your kids, don't get cable.
Oh, you have that DirecTV, yeah? Nicole 25, Nicole.
Hi. Thanks for taking my call. I had a pretty severe cocaine addiction for about a year, and I was able to get off of it. Been clean for about 6 months, and I really want to stay off of it. But a friend had gotten me some X, which I'd never tried, and wanted to try it, and because I didn't really know what was in it. And now that I have it, I found out what was in it, and that there's heroin speed in it. And I'm kind of wondering that if I take something that has speed in it, that it's going to make me more susceptible to
Nicole,
going back.
You take anything that triggers the reward systems of the brain, and your disease is reactivated. And if you're not in recovery, you're sort of spinning your wheels anyway. But you clearly are not. You're not in a program.
No.
And you have to. You must change the internal circumstances, the internal workings of your emotional world, or you will continue to need something to regulate how you deal with feelings. The whole process of recovery is sort of internalizing a new regulatory system so you don't feel the impulse, the need to go out and discharge with these stimulants or discharge with partying, whatever it is you're doing. Probably you're using, what addicts do when they get off a drug, if they're not in recovery, they'll replace it with sex and fast cars and thrill seeking and other substances. They just cross over. And
food.
Food, shopping, gambling, and then eventually one of those behaviors or substances will take off. You must get into recovery. You're just waiting for the next phase of your disease to take off.
Do you actually recover and you're not an addict anymore, or do you just?
You're an addict. You're always an addict, but insofar as you haven't, you've triggered something in your brain that is not going to change, and you have the emotional circumstances that led you to need to use substances to regulate in the first place, and both those things require treatment or. It's just virtually 100% that you're going to keep using.
Okay.
And here we are. You're now off into ecstasy, which is the sort of, I'd rather see you use cocaine, frankly.
Is it really that much worse? Because cocaine's pretty bad.
Well,
listen, right now, again, anything that triggers the reward system is activation of your disease. So behaviors that induce thrill are activating your system. So driving fast or extreme sports or sex or gambling, alcohol, pot, cocaine, speed, ecstasy, any of the hallucinogenics.
Pretty much anything that makes up America.
Well, no, benzodiazepines, opiates, which includes heroin, Vicodin, all the codeine. Any of these things will maintain the activation of that reward system. They all go through different mechanisms, but they ultimately go to a same region of the brain called the nucleus accumbens, which now has been, it's a part that is slightly different in people who are addictively prone. Their biology is addictively prone to conditioning of that part of the brain. Basically, it's basically a hijacking of the survival centers of the brain. We're talking about the part of the brain that delivers reward for surviving. And now the whole nature of reward has been confused with the delivery of the chemical to that part of the brain. And now it's been intensified beyond the normal survival instincts and focused on a pharmacologic agent. It's pretty heavy stuff. Yes? You seem to be lost in thought.
No. I was just sitting here thinking, I tried X once, and I thought I was going to hump a Volkswagen. So,
Mackenzie, 16. Mackenzie? Caller who goes by Mackenzie. Gone. Jake, 15.
Yeah?
What's going on?
What's up? Where did Adam go?
Who cares?
Okay.
He's in the Aspen. I'm sorry, I haven't repeated this tonight. He's at the Aspen Comedy Festival with Jimmy, the man show. The genius is behind the man show, don't you know?
Okay.
Sure.
Just want to say I loved Varsity Blues. That was like
Thanks, man.
Favorite movies.
I appreciate that.
Yeah. And I have like a small like lump on the underside of like right below the head of my penis on the underside of it. But it's like the size of like the lead of a pencil.
Could it be a scar from circumcision?
No, it's I can see that you could see the scar, but it's like off to the side and it's only visible when it's erect.
It's a bump.
It's a bump?
It's a bump, dude.
Yeah, it looks
Do you
like
masturbate a lot?
Not really.
Well, it's probably nothing. It could be an old clotted vein or something. There's all kinds of stuff that can cause bump. You get calcifications in that area, but
maybe it's a pimple.
Well, he only sees it when it's erect. I mean, it's in the soft tissue under the skin. So I would sure want to see you have a doctor look at that. Not necessarily when you're erect. He or she'll be able to sort of examine that area without an erection. Don't worry. But just to be sure it's nothing. The funny things can happen down there, and so get it checked out. Brian, 17.
Hi. They think this is a bogus call, but it's not, because I said that I got molested a week ago, and it's been going on for 8 years, but it was an isolated incident. So
Wait.
Huh?
Same person's been molesting you for 8 years?
Uh-huh.
And then you had another victimization this week, or the same person came back around?
Same person.
Who is this guy?
Or girl.
Guy.
Yeah. It's my friend, my best friend.
And he started when you were 9?
Yeah.
Wow. That's pretty heavy. Who molested him?
His father.
There you go.
Okay, so My problem is that when I reach orgasm, I get stomach pains.
Well, look, first of all bets are off about how you feel about your sexuality. You've been embroiled in something that you feel very conflicted about, and that needs to be dealt with. Are you just having sex with him?
No, no.
Who else are you having sex with?
And it's not really sex. It's not penetration. It's kind of just like dry humping.
Just with him or with other people?
Just with this guy. And I have a fiance. And...
Are you having sex with her?
Yeah.
You want to get married at 17?
18.
That kind of quick. What's that going to rescue you from?
Nothing. I mean, I live on my own. I have a good job, steady job.
You're 17.
I know,
but... Did you finish high school?
No, not yet. GED.
What's going on in your home?
My dad's kind of mentally abusive, and I self-inflict abuse with cigarette butts. And
you burn yourself?
Shards of glass, yeah.
Brian, you ever been treated for all this?
No, I have bipolar, and I'm kind of having a manic bipolar episode right now.
All right, why aren't you being treated?
Huh?
Why aren't you being treated?
I am.
Okay, what are you taking?
I just ran out of medication like a week ago.
All right, so does that surprise you that your bipolar illness would go out of control when you stop taking the medicine?
Yeah, but I'm not doing it deliberately, you know.
Right, get the medicine, okay? You got to get the medicine, get back on it. All bets are off until you get that biology settled. A lot of people don't realize how sort of pernicious bipolar illness can be. It's like having a seizure disorder. And when it gets going, it doesn't matter sort of what that person wants to be happening to them. There's a biology operating that needs to be settled down before they can make good decisions or really even gain insight into what it is they're doing.
Could that guy be taking has knowledge of that?
He does now, I hope, Brian.
No, I'm just talking about his...
He's just taking advantage of the fact that he's bipolar? Well, there's a lot more going on than just bipolar here.
Yeah.
He's been being abused since he was 9. He's abusive dad, just awful.
Yeah, I hope he gets help.
At least he's being treated. He's got to not run out of his medicine. He's got to get back on the medicines. He has to contact the people who are treating him and stay with it. LaToya, who is 19.
Mm-hmm.
What's going on?
Well, not much. I'm always just wondering... my husband wants to try anal sex, and we have this book, the sex position book.
Hang on a second, LaToya. We are just running out of time. I'm going to talk to you just after this break, okay? Can you hang on a second?
Mm-hmm.
All right, hold on. The guest tonight is Ron Lester. He plays Sugar Daddy on Popular Thursdays, 8 p.m. WB. Also, recurring guest role on Freaks and Geeks. Seidelman, I got that right this time.
That's awesome.
And Ron's doing a great job here. I'm Dr. Drew. Adam is away at the Aspen Comedy Festival displaying his genius, don't you know? And we'll be right back.
LoveLine, 1-800-LOVE-191. Back in a minute.
Well, it's worth hearing.
Outrageous talk radio, 100.7 The Buzz,
KQBZ,
Seattle.
LoveLine on
radio station.
Outrageous talk radio, 100.7 The Buzz,
KQBZ,
Seattle.
Okay, Dr. Drew here. Hang on, Ron Lester's here, our guest. He's from Popular. He plays Sugar Daddy. He's
Hello.
Also recurring role Seidelman on Freaks and Geeks. And he's been doing a great job tonight. And you mentioned something about this called LaToya, who had the anal sex question, is no longer with us. She just dropped off the line. But in her stead is Cara, who's 19. Cara? Cara?
Yeah?
What's going on?
Hello. Hi, Dr. Drew.
Hi, Cara.
I've been having heart flutters or palpitations,
kind of.
And I was wondering if maybe it's from my birth control pills.
Is it like a skip beat, like you feel like your heart's sort of stopping for a second, or is it very, very rapid sustained beats? Is it ba 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 ba, or is it ba 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 bum, ba 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 bum?
There's been times where it just kind of like feels like it skips a beat.
Yeah, the
but
skipping.
There's also other times where it feels like my heart's gonna jump out of my chest.
But it's all. But because it's going very, very fast, like sort of hummingbird's wings.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a serious deal. If you've got sustained fast rhythms, even though they're only staying for a few seconds, is something that a doctor should be alerted to immediately.
EKG.
Yeah, and more than that, you may need a heart monitor that you wear to see if we can capture one of those rhythms. Or you may even need to be hospitalized to check it out. It could be your birth control pills, but the birth control pills would typically cause those irregular rhythms that you're talking about, where there's sort of a skip beat, and you can feel kind of a fluttering in the chest with them. And it feels very funny and uncomfortable sometimes. And those are typically completely benign. They mean nothing. But sustained rapid rhythms is slightly different, and those can break down into other things.
Hey, Carr, do you smoke?
Do I?
Yeah.
Sometimes. Not like usually like a habit. Usually when I'm...
I mean regular cigarettes, not weed.
Sometimes.
Yeah.
Just kind of occasionally. It's not anything that I'm worried about.
Well, here's the thing. My sister died. And I'm not trying to scare you, okay? So please don't think I'm trying to do that to you.
Okay.
My favorite sister died. And
how old was she?
She was 30. Well, she was, her first heart attack was 25.
Oh, my God.
And what it was she was taking birth control, but she also smoked.
Ugh.
And at that time, when she was 25, kids our age didn't have heart attacks.
Yeah.
Okay. And so they misdiagnosed her. And a week later, they say it was like her gallbladder or something was messing up. Was not her heart. But it was, because they brought her in like 2-3 days later, and her heart was so enlarged.
Oh, jeez.
They did a skin graft the size of a postcard. Mm. And they said basically what everything led down to the fact that she smoked and took birth control pills, and it's basically like a stick of dynamite and a match.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And so they tried a heart transplant or anything on her?
Couldn't. Her tissue was just so far weakened. She actually lived 10 years longer than we thought she would.
Wow. Well, listen, Cara, certainly as you get older, the risks of adding, and I don't emphasize this enough, frankly, late 20s, early 30s, smoking plus birth control pill is not a good idea. All right, but do check with your doctor about these episodes of sustained rhythm problems, because that is, could be a serious deal. This is Sean, 16. Sean?
Yeah.
What's up?
Well, about 3 weeks ago, I had a chance to sleep with someone who's actually quite a bit older than me. She was 19. I was 15 at the time. I wasn't extremely attracted to her, but I decided to give it a chance because a couple of my friends kind of wanted to borrow her car, so tried to influence me.
That's a good payoff. You have sex with her, they borrow your car. That's good. I like that.
Well, it was a 2000 Honda. But anyways, yeah. So I didn't really want to do it, but anyways, I went with the car ride for her, and I tried to have sex with her, but I really didn't want to, and I couldn't get it up, and for about 2 weeks after that, I had a hard time just getting hard overall.
Well, just you get freaked out when that happens to you. Guys your age. It happens all the time, by the way.
You're 15, dude.
And
I'm
yeah.
16 now.
Yeah, you didn't want to be there. You were overwhelmed by the experience, and just the anxiety about the possibility of this happening again makes it happen again.
Dude, even if you did want to be there, I mean, yeah. Dude, when those legs spread open, a lot of guys start to go, wow.
Well, she didn't look too good. I've had sex before. Just yeah, look, kind listen, of different.
Do the bag thing, dude. Put the bag over her head.
Oh, Jesus, Ron.
Oh,
ladies and gentlemen, Ron Lester, thank you.
Yeah.
Be here all night. But listen, Sean, you're freaked out. You're anxious. That's what makes this happen. Just calm down, relax. Everything's gonna be fine. This is Alan, 19.
Yeah, just
And by the way, sorry, Alan. One second. And if there's one thing, piece of advice I could give people is let's not be exploitative of one another. People, let's show a little empathy, a little respect, a little mutuality in our relationships. Please,
can't we all just get along?
Oh, for Christ's sake, Alan. What's the deal?
I'm disappointed to hear that the buffoon is not in the studio tonight.
What about him?
He's not in the studio tonight. I'm disappointed to hear that.
You're disappointed?
Yeah.
Shut up, damn it! Did he say the buffoon?
Yeah.
Yeah,
but
he's funny, though.
I'm kind of excited about him not being here.
Unacceptable.
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 Unacceptable. Unacceptable.
What? Oh. All right, but I was going to ask you, when I drink beer, like a lot of it, and I'm in like 12 cans or whatever, my lower back starts to hurt pretty bad. Like, I mean, last time it happened, it got so bad where I couldn't even like stand. I just had to lay down.
You're drunk, dude.
Yeah, but like my back's not supposed to hurt.
Yeah, that's interesting.
I mean
kidneys maybe.
Yeah, but why? Right in the middle, is it?
It's just it's lower, and it's kind of on the like left side.
You ever had kidney stones?
Huh? Like, I don't know.
Yeah, you need to have that evaluated. Now, there's nothing specific that comes to mind that's typically caused by that. You worry about gout. Maybe there's a sacroiliitis or something. You worry about stones, kidney stones. But again, you're taking so much fluid, you would hope that wouldn't be likely to happen. Could it be a bladder phenomenon, which tends to refer to the back? Yeah, but what about the bladder? Could it be prostate inflammation?
Could he have like a what's that nerve? Sciatic nerve?
Sciatica. Yeah, but why would that be triggered by alcohol?
Right, yeah, and I'm like as big as Ronnie, too, so I don't know.
Good man. There you go.
I should be able to handle that stuff, but...
Yeah,
dude, I can't even handle a 12 can.
Yeah, that's a lot of alcohol, so I'm not quite sure. But I would absolutely have it looked into, because there could be something wrong with the kidneys, and you don't want to let that go for any period of time.
Let me just say this real quick, dude. If you're drinking that much and you're like me, back it off, dude. That's a lot of empty calories. It's going to stick with you, and it's going to be hell burning it off.
Now,
trust me.
You're going to go do a weight program now. Coming up.
Yeah, I'm going to check into Duke University in April.
It's a great program.
Yeah, it's 6 weeks, and yeah. It's just...
That's the best program in the country right now, I think. I've talked to several people who have been through that and just loved it.
Well, I heard, what got me started was I heard that Chris Farley went, and Don DeLuise goes,
also... Caroline Ray went. I was talking to her about it.
Oh, really?
Great. Yeah.
Well, I heard also Big Pun went, and he went, when he checked in, he was like 700-something pounds. Obviously, I'm nowhere near that big, but...
Wow.
And unfortunately, he just died.
Who is he now?
Big Pun, the rapper.
Oh, really?
The Punisher. I mean, he was a talented rapper, too. I had a lot of respect for this guy, but he was a big boy. I mean, he made Big Boy on Power seem small.
Wow.
Okay? And he just died. I mean, it's a wake-up call, dude. I mean,
You said you're on Xenical, which is the stuff that prevents fat absorption and lets it all flow out in your stool.
I don't recommend that to nobody.
You didn't like that?
Dude, man, I had to go buy underwear.
Oh, wow. Mark, what's the deal? 29.
Hey, how you doing?
We're good.
Good. I started smoking pot when I was 15.
Yeah.
Between 16 and, say, 22 or so, I did LSD probably 30 to 40 hits in my life. I continually smoke pot now, pretty much on a daily basis. And I, at this point, I'm addicted to it, and I also help use it to control mood swings. But I'm not sure if some of that's, mood swings caused from possibly not smoking, possible LSD use.
Well, the LSD use is the most prominent cause of severe mood disturbances. But the marijuana is not the treatment for it. It will make it worse. So I know you get relief in the moment, but it makes the entire syndrome more intense as time goes along. And stopping by yourself is not an option, because the depressions will get very severe when you try smoking the pot. Stop smoking the pot.
Well, part of my problem is, too, though, I called the local hospital and tried to talk to a psychiatrist who could potentially prescribe some drugs to help me get through this.
No, you have to be in a program. There's no way that somebody could, over the phone, do anything to help you. This is something you have to be involved with on a daily basis for many, many weeks.
Do you have insurance?
Health, but I don't think they cover anything like that.
Of course they do. Of course they do, Mark. Of course they do.
Okay. They got free clinics too, man.
Well, it's hard to find. There are out there, and you basically have to go to sober living, and even that's not free. You have to be able to pay at least the monthly rate there. But you need to get the depression treated. One circumstance in which I suggest addicts get treated for the depression immediately is when there's been a heavy LSD history, because I guarantee the mood disturbances are going to be profound, and they're going to confound your ability to stay sober. And if that isn't treated as a wholly separate issue from the addiction, it's going to make the addiction almost impossible to treat. But you can't expect the addiction to settle down just by treating the depression. That will never work. You've got to do both. It takes a lot of time, a lot of work to treat the addiction. Mary, who's 17. Mary.
Hey, my boyfriend and I have been trying to have sex, but I think he's too big.
Uh-oh. What's the matter? What's the matter, Ron?
No, Mary, can I tell you something?
Yeah.
I don't think this is a pretty common thing, dude.
You bet it, especially at this age.
Really?
Yeah.
It's not about being too big, though.
Yeah, because I got to be honest. I'll share some with your listeners, ready?
I'm ready. This is the way we reset. Ron Lester plays Sugar Daddy on Popular. You can see him Thursdays, 8 p.m., WB. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
I remember, the first time I had sex, I was so afraid that my penis wasn't large enough because I'm a big guy, right? Mm. You know, you always hear the story about how big guys have small pee-pees, which isn't true. But I was so embarrassed. I was scared. And then when I finally actually had sex with a girl.
Didn't get up.
No, it was all there.
Oh, okay.
It was all good.
Yeah.
But she actually was like trying to put a condom on me. She was like going, oh, it's too small. And I about died. I almost died.
The condom was too small? She said, or the penis
she
was
just
too
said
small
it's too small. I instantly thought she said penis.
Yeah.
I mean, I thought she was talking about penis. Turns out she's talking about the condom. Yeah.
And when she told you. So no, she says.
Hey, man.
She maintains that to this day.
Work with me, Drew.
That's
work
right.
with me,
go
Drew.
Ahead. Go ahead.
You're not Adam. No, but, and then when I was actually having sex with her, she said, you know, that she was, it was really hard to get inside her because it was very, nice.
Well, Mary, here's a real common thing when people are getting going with this, and that is something called vaginismus, which is where, for women, the muscles in the pelvis sort of contract down. If you're not really relaxed and really into it, that whole area has to relax a good deal in order for things to work. And to a more or lesser extent, women can get contracturing of those muscles and make it impossible for anything to get in there without causing you a lot of discomfort.
Oh.
She's probably nervous.
Yeah, you're nervous. And your body's telling you something. Maybe you're not really ready for this, or at least if you're ready for it, maybe not in the circumstances in which you guys are trying.
Oh.
You understand? And there can be some disproportion. I mean, if the guy is substantially bigger, that makes it all that more challenging.
Like I was.
Okay. But remember, this is a piece of the anatomy that's designed to handle a baby's cranium and spring back into action no problem. So should be able to handle most guys without any big difficulty. This is Tom of 16. Tom?
Hey.
Hey.
Yes, I have a tiny white bumps. They're like the size of a whitehead on a pimple on my penis. And I don't know.
Are they symmetrical?
They're just like, yeah, they're round. And
Wait, no. Are they distributed symmetrically around the penis?
No, they're like fully from the top, from the, almost to the base to the almost to where the head starts. They're like there's a bunch of them.
Okay,
and,
have you ever had sex?
What, a long time ago when I was like 10 with a neighbor girl, just messing around playing like,
doctor.
Yeah.
You put your penis inside her?
Yeah.
How old was she?
But, I don't... Is that normal?
Because he doesn't
what?
Answer.
How old was she when you
How
did
How old
that?
Was she?
What? Like, same age.
Wow.
I didn't know a long time ago.
Wow.
Wow.
Well, I suppose there's a possibility it's warts. I don't know. God knows what was happening to her to lead her to allow you to do that. But most probably, this is something called the pearly penile papules.
Mm-hmm.
Which
I'm sorry,
are
what was that?
Pearly penile papules, which are normal little growths around the base of the penis, sometimes around the head, too.
They just made a funnier name for that?
I know. Isn't that funny?
Pearly. Yes, I got pearls.
Pearly penile papules. That's them.
PPP.
Chris is 17. That's right.
Yeah, me?
Yeah.
Oh, hey. The screener got my question wrong.
All right, go.
Okay. My girlfriend, we haven't had sex yet, but when we started kissing, she, like, bit my lip lots of times and drew blood.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Is she a vamp?
Huh?
Is she a vamp?
No.
Did she know she was going to...
She stuck on my lip after she drew blood.
Did she know she was going to draw blood? Was that
I
her?
Don't know.
Is she...
After she said that she was sort of caught up in it, and later on we tried it again, and she, like, bit my ear and drew blood.
Dude, your girlfriend's in a kinky, rough sex, dude.
I don't know. I'm not sure yet.
Well, she's into something.
Be careful if she goes down on you. That's all I'm saying. If she drew blood there, woo!
No, I'd rather not.
Game over.
Yeah.
I have a whole new Bobbitt situation.
All right, Chris. And if I can emphasize, there were a lot of sexual activity tonight. Wear condoms, people. And if you need access to condoms, we are giving them away free at drdrew.com. You just log on, one word, drdrew.com. And there's a condom on the homepage. You click on that, condom sent to you immediately. Just put your address in there. So you have to be over 16. But please, if you're having trouble getting access to these things, there it is. No problem anymore.
And you know what? If you're under 16, have your parents call for you.
Well, ask your parents. Andrew is 19.
Hi.
Hey.
Basically, I just have a question about, like, when I have sex, it happened with my ex-boyfriend, and it happens, like, now. It's happened, like, 6 times. Sometimes it starts to hurt really, really bad. It feels like someone is stabbing me.
Is that right at the beginning, right when they're penetrating, or that later?
It's later.
And where's the pain?
It's hard to explain. It feels like it's, like, right under my belly button, kind of.
Okay. You had a pelvic exam recently?
Yeah, and every time I've had a pap smear, I mean, I mentioned it to my gynecologist, and she did the pap smear and stuff, and those hurt really bad, too.
Yeah.
And she just didn't say any. She just said everything came out normal.
And it was a gynecologist you saw?
Yeah.
You're sure of that?
Yeah.
Well, then things should be okay. They're pretty astute at picking things up. But you worry about inflammation or infections in the tubes. You worry about endometriosis, ovarian cysts, inflammation or infection of the uterus itself, a tipped uterus. There's all sorts of things that can cause this symptom.
Yeah.
My advice is to go back in there and really push on them for an explanation.
Yeah.
But this is just not acceptable and you need some help.
It doesn't just hurt like while I'm doing, like afterwards too.
Yeah, and that's sort of typical, that sort of visceral pain, like it's inside you, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's some viscera being stirred up in a way that it shouldn't be. You never had any infections or anything?
I had like a bladder infection when I was 5. But
no, never any pelvic inflammatory disease or anything like that.
No.
Chlamydia. Yeah, make sure they do a chlamydia test, Andrea, right?
Okay.
All right. A chlamydia
good
test.
Luck.
Thanks.
There's various ways to do it. Actually, you have you pee on something, they can do the test very, very rapidly. It's just they can do a culture or DNA smear, all kinds of things they can do to check out chlamydia.
Pee on the stick.
Pee on the stick is something they can do.
You think that'd be like a common thing? I mean, like part of the process.
Well, if she's having symptoms, you sure would. So, yeah. Veronica's 20. Although this didn't manage care these days, Jesus Christ! You know, you have to be overtly convinced of what is going on before you're allowed to create a test. In Medicare, it's a bizarre thing. You're not allowed to order a lab test unless you already know what the answer is. They make you put a code.
What?
This is how sick the system is. They make you put a code. Now, let's say I want to measure your electrolytes and blood sugar.
Right.
In order for me to order that test, I have to write down your diagnosis is diabetes and be able to defend that.
No way.
Is that nuts? Yeah, it's nuts. Okay, Veronica. Veronica, 20.
That's stupid.
Oh, yeah.
My question's about birth control.
Yeah?
Does it matter what month you start on?
You mean, like, what sign of the zodiac we're in?
Hmm?
So, Veronica, hang on 1 second, kiddo. We got to take a quick break here, all right?
Okay.
The guest is Ryan Lester, Sugar Daddy Unpopular.
Hello.
Number here is 1-800-LOVE-199 with a... Am I even understandable tonight? I'm kind of tired. I'm just so giddy and happy to be without Adam, who's at the Aspen Comedy Festival. Graciously, I've been allowed to continue the show by myself. Number is 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number 310-854-4455. It is Loveline. We'll be right back.
Loveline with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
1-800-LOVE-191.
We'll be right back.
This is Loveline on Outrageous Talk Radio, 100.7 The Buzz.
You know what? Next time we talk to him?
Manco?
Yeah, tell me, no me.
Hey, it's Loveline. I'll say it. Ron Lester sent me.
Loveline!
Ron Lester from the popular Popular.
Popular!
And also from the popular Freaks and Geeks.
Freaks and Geeks!
Seidelman is his character there. And what's the name of the character in Popular?
Sugar Daddy.
Sugar Daddy, that's right. Who is the standard, usual, average experience of the usual couple hundred pound high school student, rapper, man about campus,
all-state
guard.
He's a pimp.
Yeah, all those things that every high school student actually is. And,
or claims to be.
Yeah, right. The number is 1-800-LOVE-191, fax 310-854-4455. I am Dr. Drew. Adam Carolla is away at the Aspen Comedy Festival with his cohort and compatriot in crime, Jimmy Kimmel, who, you know, these are the brains behind the illustrious and very educational program, The Man Show.
And I hate doctors.
I say all bow down and praise Drew.
Thank you. This is Veronica we're getting back to. She is 20. Veronica.
Yes?
You asked, does it matter what month you start the birth control pill?
Mm-hmm.
I don't even understand the question.
Okay, well, I'll explain. I was supposed to start in December, but I didn't because I was going to go visit my parents for the holidays, and I really didn't want them to know, but I haven't really started yet. So I was wondering if...
Why would they know anyway? Why? I mean, you take a pill, you know, you hide it, you know, you swallow it. It's not like it's going to come back out.
How are your parents? How would your parents find out?
They have a way of finding out stuff.
Well, they go through your stuff or something?
Your parents are that intrusive? Are they?
Pretty much.
Are they abusive?
No, they weren't.
They weren't, but they could be.
No.
I don't understand.
Let's reenact this. Ron, were your parents abusive?
No. Nope.
Okay. Veronica.
Yeah.
It's not. They weren't. They could be.
No,
I don't know.
No, my parents were not abusive to me, no.
Okay, why are you so frightened of them?
Well, I'm not. I just don't. I don't like them going through my stuff because then they...
Well, then don't let them go through your stuff.
How long are we going to be at your parents?
Huh?
How long are we going to be at your parents?
Just for the holidays.
Why would they go through your stuff?
Take your pill before you leave and then leave it at home.
Give me your pocket.
Well, you're going to
take it every day.
Yeah.
Take it every day.
Yeah, that's right.
Keep it in your pocket or keep it in your I mean, are they going to search your luggage? Why are you so afraid of them? That is not normal, Veronica. You're an adult. You're nearly 21. You should be taking care of at least your reproductive health. That's part of being a mature person.
Are you Catholic by chance?
And by the way, I'm sure the doctor didn't say, oh, December, let's see, Sagittarius. This is when you must start the pill.
Look at your horoscope, girl. Come on.
Come on. You just need to start it as instructed after your period or during your period, depending which pill you're taking. And that's that. You take it. Veronica, there's something just way up with you. What's going on? You going to share with us at all?
Something deeper.
Well, I was abused, but not by them.
Okay. All right.
Do you have brothers and sisters?
Huh? I can't hear you.
Do you have brothers and sisters?
Yeah, I do.
Who abused you?
My uncle.
And whose brother was that?
My mom.
Okay. So mom must be a kind of piece of work, too.
Does mom know about this or no?
Yeah, she knows.
And did they send you for treatment or?
My mom didn't talk to me for a while.
Was she blamed you for it?
Yeah.
Oh, please. That's abuse right there.
Wow.
That is unreasonable.
She didn't talk to me for a while.
Unacceptable. Veronica,
what'd your dad do?
A mess.
Oh, my. Unacceptable. My dad was not very happy about it.
And no wonder, did they have your uncle arrested?
Mm-hmm.
Good.
He's gone.
Okay, good. But no wonder you have issues about your sexuality, particularly as it pertains to your parents, given how they reacted last time.
But they blamed her for it.
Oh,
she has pregnancy pills.
Listen, make sure you use a condom if you're worried about STD and this is somebody...
I haven't been doing anything, so...
All right, well, get on the pill just in case. You're on the pill?
I am going to be, yeah.
All right, good. Get on it. Perfect. Don't worry. Don't wait till December 2000. Do it now. Man, this is Alex, 20. Alex.
Hi, Dr. Drew.
Hey.
Thanks for taking my call.
Sure.
I respect you and I appreciate your honesty.
Oh, my pleasure. What's going on?
I've been struggling with anorexia and bulimia for about 4 years.
Yeah.
Started when I was 16 and I'm 20 now.
All right.
I've been in outpatient therapy on and off for about 3 years. I got to the point over this past summer where it was just so completely out of my control, just like the not eating and then the binging and purging,
mm-hmm.
that I was hospitalized in Philadelphia at an eating disorders hospital.
Great, excellent.
And
I'm sorry that you had to go through that, but that's the way to deal with this.
No. I mean, my parents are very supportive, and it was a mutual agreement. Nobody made me go. It was
it's good. That's good.
Yeah, so I learned a lot about myself. I put on a good 30 pounds, that I needed.
Congratulations.
I know, and it was really hard because I came home, and the next day I relapsed. And
which does happen.
Sure.
I know. It's really hard.
And as you know, it's a chronic disease, and relapse is part of this disease.
I just feel really weak, though, because it's completely taken over my life. Mm-hmm. And I haven't had a life for 4 years. I've spent it with my head in the toilet. So I was hospitalized again after that in a hospital around where I live, which is in Boston. Okay. And after that, I was supposed to be in close contact with
I have a therapist, psychiatrist, and a primary care physician.
Great.
And I just always manage to jump through the cracks and, you know, not call my therapist.
So you're really afraid of letting go of this disease. You're just scared to death, huh?
But I can't live like this. I've wasted.
Yeah, but you can't. But clearly, the fear of getting better is more intense.
I mean, I've done it for that month. I did it, you know, and then there was a couple of days.
In my experience with people with situations like this, one experience I've had, and actually I can't really characterize it in any just consistent way, but one sort of experience I've noticed is that people in your situation really feel like they will just sort of fall into an abyss without the eating.
I call it my oblivion.
Yeah.
I've floated off.
And you will just sort of cease to exist or be annihilated lest you let go of this one thing.
Yes. It's my identity, and that's what I feel like.
And boy, it ain't. And the problem is your brain doesn't have any other options available right now. And until you develop a stable relationship with a team that you sort of internalize, that's sort of there in your emotional world to let you fall upon as opposed to fall through, it's going to be very difficult if you let go of this. You've got to just get yourself to that structure. Alex, please.
There's a reason, actually, that I was calling.
but you're just avoiding what I'm saying.
No. I've been told it. You know, I am really good at avoiding. I understand it. I know you're right. I just don't want to hear it.
You heard that, huh?
You just did it.
Yeah.
But the point, what I really want to know is, I mean, they all tell me everywhere pretty much, you know, it's not just going to go away. You're going to have good days and bad days, and it's baby steps, sort of.
Right.
And whoever screened my call was really great and actually said, you know, she had been through it too, which was really nice. What my point is that they say it's like baby steps, and it won't just go away, and it's just giving me leeway because it's just saying, oh, okay, you know, I can keep doing this. And
Alec, but you're looking for any reason to avoid and to slip out of this.
What I want to know is what exactly is happening inside of me, and what are the...
You know what? I'm not going to gratify you with an answer. Really, because it's taking the focus off what you need to do, which is follow direction.
No, I know.
Alex,
I know.
Seriously, it's gonna. You're gonna die. Do we need to know any more than that?
No. Well, part of me is terrified that one of these times is going to be the last, and it's going to kill me.
Of course, it will.
But the other part of me is really oblivious to what I'm doing to my body, and not only the malnutrition, but the actual purging. And I just no physical things.
I'm not going to gratify, but Ron is. I think.
Hey, Alex, can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Listen, I'm like the epitome of everything you don't want to be. You know? I mean, I'm a pretty big guy. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've been in I'm at the other end of your spectrum.
Of the same
disease.
Right. Okay? I think
Hold on. Let me ask you something. Without avoiding, without trying to change it, without trying to go back to whatever you think your question is. Someone asked me one time, what do I need? Has anybody ever asked you that?
Yeah. Well, no.
Wait, hold on. Alex, you said, yeah. What do you need? Not looking for answers, not looking for... the fix, not looking for, you know, this is something that's not just in your heart. This is something that's in your head, too. And you can't be thinking with your brain all the time. What's one of the things in your heart that, you know, that you need?
Thank you. I know that that's something I'm avoiding, you know.
What is it?
I guess just my appearance has been the only thing I've been accepted for. And I guess I'm just looking to be accepted for anything I can be accepted for, and that's all it's been. I don't know if that makes any sense.
No, it does to me.
I appreciate that. And it's just hard because I'm, like, addicted to this way of life.
Yeah, I know.
I can't live like this. And I know, I'm sorry, I'm monopolizing this whole show.
But you just got to follow direction, Alex. You've got to follow direction. And really what people, there's another word. Well, I think love is the trivial word people use, but connection is the one I think people really want.
I want to say this. I know you got some other calls. I just got to get
Alex, listen, you know, like I said, just when you get to that point and, you know, you feel like you want to, like, purge, vomit, whatever, just ask yourself, you know, what do you need? And it's with your heart, not your head, but your heart. Because, you know, I have the same thing. My food, my size is, it's a security blanket. You know, it's for every bad date I went on, or every girl that turned me down, or the stress I'm having by, you know, from being on the show, you know, from, you know, whatever, you know, not getting that movie or that movie or whatever. It's something I hide behind, and where you vomit and purge whatever, I eat, you know, and I'm a closet eater, and I had to come out and I had to admit that. But I still think, you know, you're never going to get over it, but as long as you need to recognize yourself and visually and verbally say to yourself, what do you need, you know?
Follow directions, Alex. Follow directions. That's all you got to do, and I agree with what Ron's telling you. JoJo's 18.
So whenever me and my boyfriend, like, want to have sex, he always just wants to, like, go right into it. But how do I get him to stimulate me before?
To do what before?
Stimulate.
Ron, we're going to switch gears fast on you. Can you make the transition?
Oh, yeah.
All right. It's heavy stuff. It's that you know what you're feeling and what you're connecting with in her is that emptiness.
Right.
Mm-hmm. That abandonment, that piece of self that's just all walled off and alone.
But now we're talking about going down, eating the clam.
That's right.
Well, not even that. Just like he doesn't want to kiss. He doesn't want to hug. He doesn't want to do anything. He just wants...
So he doesn't want to do any kind of foreplay at all?
Yeah.
Okay, that's bogus. You know, I mean, I was looking at your question a while ago that the lady sent in here, and I told Dr. Drew, I said, man, I'm sorry, that's the first thing I do is I go down and I try to find the little man in the boat. You know what I mean?
He doesn't mind it doing when I tell him I don't want to do anything until he does it, but I just want him to do it on his own, you know? Just.
You want him to spontaneously do it, huh?
Yeah.
Ain't going to happen. Some guys are just not
they don't understand, or care enough, or whatever it is.
Unacceptable.
They don't know. They're lame. Guys are lame, basically, and you got to direct them. And if a guy can't take direction, then you've really got a problem. But most guys, if you sort of prompt them, right, they'll deliver. What do you think?
You know what? Tell him to go down on you first.
Yeah.
Just tell him.
And by the way, you hold all the cards, JoJo.
Trust me, you do.
Yeah, women don't understand that. They don't understand that.
Oh, I know.
Understand why not? Men are scared to death of what you guys have. Right. You are completely in control.
Oh, look, you know what? You know what? Actually, let me tell you this. This is what I finally realized. Women need two things. My penis and my money. They don't need me. Basically, I'm a 300-pound walking wallet.
They said they needed your tongue.
Oh, my tongue's good, too.
All right. They need that also. It's Ron Lester. He plays Sugar Daddy. Indeed, it lives right up to his role on the show Popular Thursday, 8 p.m. WB. Also, Seidelman on Freaks and Geeks. Freaks and Geeks is when?
Monday night, 8.
Mondays at 8. On NBC?
Yes, yeah.
NBC. I don't know. I just did a webcast at DrDrew.com with Busy Phillips, who is another Freaks and Geeks
She's
type.
Awesome.
She plays Kim. She plays Kim. She's great. And this is Loveline. We'll be right back. Oh,
baby. Yo, Loveline will be right back, homie.
This is Loveline on Outrageous Talk Radio, 100.7 The Buzz.
Loveline, 1-800-LOVE-191. What's that, Ron?
That's salami for dinner, man. It's just
salami?
Kicking my ass.
Reflux, dude. You have to take Prilosec or Pepcid or anything? Salami and onions, that's nice.
I smell good or what?
Boy, you really tend to that diet, don't you?
At least I didn't eat chili.
They caught you a lot there. Yeah, you're going to Duke soon. Good.
At least I didn't eat the chili.
LOVE191. Text number 310-854-4455. You guys got to check the fax machine for me to see if there's anything coming through. Ron Lester is the guest. He plays Sugar Daddy on Popular, and we're going right back to the phones. Dave, 27.
Hi.
Hey.
Dr. Drew.
Hey, Dave.
Listen, I appreciate your time. I've been married a couple of years, and my wife is 25, and she's had her first child about 10 months ago. And since then, she's had trouble, I guess, lubricating, you know.
That's a pretty common thing. All sorts of changes in sexual arousal can occur, particularly for the first year after a child is born.
Okay. Well, still, you know, she says, you know, she's the one that usually initiates it.
Is she still breastfeeding?
No, she's not.
And she's just not into it anymore the way she used to be?
Oh, no, she's into it. It's just that when it comes down to, you know, her getting lubricated, it just doesn't happen, you know.
She's still initiating the same way.
Yeah. Huh. You know, everything else except that one thing is...
Have her talk to her obstetrician about maybe going on some birth control pills, something like that. Sometimes sort of helping them with their circulating estrogen levels for a while helps them out a lot.
Okay, she is on Orthonovum or birth control or whatever.
Is that the pill she's been on in the past?
Yeah, she has.
So it's not as though that's causing the problem.
No.
Yeah.
No, and, you know, she's all afraid that it's in her head. Now that she started thinking that, maybe that's one of the causes. But
is she depressed?
She's depressed about the fact that, you know, she's having problems with it.
What's the big deal?
I don't know. I mean, that's the thing, you know. I try to be supportive, and we buy like over the counter lubricants, you know. But
so you are at least covering her.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I tell her it's not a major issue with me.
So she feels inadequate because of it, huh?
Yeah. She's like, well, is there something wrong with me? And the thing is, she's embarrassed about it, and she doesn't want to really go to her doctor with it.
David, it's such a common thing. I wish people would not feel so uncomfortable talking to their doctors about stuff that is important and that's common and that we, believe me, heard a million times. So,
dude, the way I see about it, my doctor, I mean, I actually, anybody who, like, grabs my nuts and tells me to cough, I feel like I can tell that person anything.
That's good. That's good. It's how it should be. But, Dave, she needs to be checked out. Maybe changing the birth control pill, maybe make sure there are no other hormonal problems. Maybe this is just one of the changes she's going to have after delivering a baby. The things that are different somewhat after that, and it may be just reassuring her that there's nothing wrong.
Is that a common thing, by the way?
Yeah.
What about if it's like a C-section or something?
There's massive changes after a child's delivered, particularly for that first year, and sometimes it can be a mood disturbance. Sharon is 18. Sharon.
Hi.
Hey.
Dr. Drew?
Sharon?
I just want to say that you're really cool, by the way.
Well, thank you.
Okay, Ron?
Yes, ma'am.
I have to say that I'm a really big fan of your show, Popular.
Thank you.
And I haven't seen Freaks and Geeks yet, but I was wondering which show you like better, or if you could choose which one you like.
He's not allowed to say.
Sorry.
No. This is the way I see it. I'm like a hoe when it comes to TV shows. Whoever pays me the most money.
So Popular right now is
right now is Popular.
And I just wanted to say something to you. The person that plays Harrison on Popular,
Chris Gorm.
Yeah, I actually found out that he's from where I live, so I thought that was kind of.
Oh really? Did you know he just got married?
Oh, he did.
He's been married for 2 weeks.
Sorry, Sharon.
Dude,
you're gonna stop watching now.
No, do you want to know who he married?
Sure.
He married Poppy Fresh.
Oh really?
Who's that?
One of the other girls in our show.
Oh wow.
I don't think I can watch the show anymore.
Ah, what about me?
Oh, Freaks and Geeks. You'll see him there.
Okay. All right.
All right, Sharon. Thanks.
Thank you, Sharon.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
She sounded kind of cute.
Yeah.
Okay.
Want to get her back on the line?
Okay.
This is Patrick, 17. Patrick?
Yeah.
Hi, what's going on?
Well, I've had it for about 3 years. I've noticed I'm attracted to lesbians even before I find out they're lesbians. And it's partly because I can have a really good friendship with them because there's not all that sexual tension, but at the same time, I want there to be that.
But so, are you into women in general?
I am. I mean, I had.
But
one.
You want to be involved with women, which there's no possibility of a real relationship.
Are you bisexual by chance?
I thought I was for a while, but I don't.
So you did experience with that?
Yeah, I did experiment with that once, but I just. And it's not that I'm afraid of commitment or anything. I just feel like I need to claim that, you know?
Dude, you pop a boner watching women having sex.
Well, it's not that either. You know, it's just that I feel like since it's like the unknown and the that since I can't conquer them, so to speak. That,
dude, you want to try and turn them over? You want to make them?
Yeah, exactly.
Dude, that's every guy's fantasy, man. What are you talking about? Dude, biggest fantasy for guys. Get two chicks in the same bed. Do them. Okay? That's one fantasy. The other fantasy is to turn a lesbian back to normal.
Yeah, watch your
Because
language.
Your biggest nightmare is turning one into a lesbian.
Back to normal. So well, there's an interesting twist on this, though. You're right that guys do tend to get that way. They tend to want to be the conqueror. And of course, that's nonsense. But you know that most men that have male-to-female sex change operations, you know, they're converted into women, do so to maintain, to have sexual relationships with lesbians.
No way.
Isn't that interesting? When I first, I dealt with some of those in the psychiatric hospital, I had to take out a piece of paper and diagram it. Let me get this right. You're going to become a woman so you can go back and have sex with a woman. Wait a minute. My brain just wouldn't compute.
See, that makes sense to me. I mean, I'd never do that, but
that's sort of where you're at.
That's
what
my
I figured.
Way of thinking.
Yeah, I figured you were sort of at that point.
Have you thought about having a sex change?
No, I mean,
but if it's a fan, if you could have a fantasy and we could just convert you for a couple hours, that's
yeah,
something
go,
is something
dude, you know
for?
What you do? You tell the girls you're gay, and then they'll feel safe about you, and they'll stay with you all the time. Girls love gay guys,
yeah, but
because they feel
he
safe.
He wants to have lesbian sex with, as a woman with the lesbian. See,
you know what you do?
If he converts,
tape it up. And use your tongue.
If he
it's
can,
the same thing.
It's the same thing. That's a good point. I like that. I like that. Good.
That's right.
But the deal is that he doesn't want to really convert them. He just wants to experience them. And the only way to really do that is to maintain their lesbianism and be with them in that respect. It's interesting.
So what should I do? I mean...
Well, I don't know what you should do. Maybe. No, I don't
I would
know.
Say you're screwed, but hey,
I don't
you don't
know.
Want that.
it's certainly a conflicted state to be in, and it's. I would hope that you could begin to have more sort of complete relationships with somebody. I don't know. If you have lesbian friends, maybe they can help you sort of through this. It's an interesting dilemma of gender identity, sexual orientation.
Do you have a lot of lesbian friends?
Hang on a second. Patrick?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Do you have a lot of lesbian friends?
I have two close lesbian friends, and then there's other acquaintances that I've been attracted to.
Well, I think you should talk to your
yeah
talk definitely to go to those friends. Girls and say, listen,
what can
help
we
me
do?
Out.
What can we do? How would this work? And maybe or just explore really who they are and what it is about them that attracts you. Maybe learn something about yourself and maybe sort of include. I suspect there are pieces of yourself you're sort of afraid of and you're sort of staying away from is bad or something. This is your way of getting in touch with them. Sarah's 18. Sarah?
Yeah. I was wondering, I have recurring yeast infections and I'm just wondering if that could be a sign of other problems.
Well, it could be a sign of an awful sinus problem.
I have a cold.
Man, do you? That's all I hear. Yeah, of course.
I think it's sexy, okay? I'm sorry.
The sinusy, the nasally voice.
I personally like the snort, you know, that whole thing.
But look, obviously you need to be sure there's not some other alteration of your immune system, diabetes, thyroid problems, something that could be affecting you. Other than that, yeast infections that are recurrent are very, very common. And one of the things you want to do is make sure you're using yeast creams when you treat it.
Okay.
And if that doesn't work, try Diflucan, fluconazole, which is a sort of more complete treatment of the yeast infection.
Is that something that I would have to get a prescription
yeah,
from my doctor?
Yeah, you would. And then beyond that, to just sort of think about any other things you might be doing to change the biology of that environment, the vagina, and whether you're putting things in or using certain kinds of tampons, things that could be changing things and might be predisposing to it, because it's a very sensitive environment, and almost anything can sort of trigger one of these things. We have to go to break. Ron Lester's our guest, and we'll be back in just a minute.
Let's have some more fun.
Okay, let's do it. Call LoveLine, 1-800-LOVE-191.
LoveLine, we'll be right back.
Well, here's how it's sampled.
Well, now.
This has been LoveLine. The stuff expressed on LoveLine is not necessarily the stuff of the staff, management, sponsors, or anyone else, including Westwood One Entertainment. LoveLine is produced by Ann Wilkins Ingold. Now, please enjoy these birds.